said in 3 days you would rise. You did. You're alive. You rule. You reign. You said you're coming back again. I know you will. All the earth will sing your praises. Our sins away, oh God. You gave your life away for us. You came down, you saved us through the cross. Our hearts are changed because of your great love. You live. Sins away, oh God. You gave your life away for us. You came down, you saved us through the cross. Our hearts are changed because of your great love. You live, you die, you save. You did. You're alive. You rule. You reign. You said you're coming back again. I know you will. All the earth will sing your praises. You live. You die. You said in 3 days you will rise. You did.
Good morning. A blessed Easter to you. We're glad that you're here with us at the Bethel Highlands, and we welcome those of you that are regulars, those of you that may be guests or visitors, those of you that maybe have come home, so to speak. You're at college and you've come back, or maybe you live apart and you're here with family, but we're just glad that you're here. We also welcome those of you that are down the hall as well. My understanding is we've got people down there. We're sorry you had to sit out there high, and even though down perhaps in the children's theater. And later, we're going to ask for all the kids to come forward at that time. So just give me a second. We'll give you the cue. Hey, I want to thank so many of you that donated flowers or money for the Easter lilies just to beautify the church on a day like today. Also, let me just share this with you. Under the seats there on the aisles are some pads with paper. Can I ask those of you that are there, will you just pass those down? And if you're new to Bethel, will you just jot down your name and address? There's nothing we're going to ask of you, but we just want to thank you for coming. Also, on the flip side, whether you're a guest or visitor or whether you're a regular, you can jot down a prayer request for somebody or something. So drop that in the offering plate a little bit later, if you will. But Again, we just want to know who's here, and we thank you for coming. Later in our service, we will celebrate Holy Communion. Please know you are all welcome. You're all invited to come and receive the sacrament with us. And the pastors will tell you more about that in just a little bit. Today, we want to thank New Song for leading us as we raise the roof, but we all want to also want to thank Peter and Chase that you're going to hear from later, and you're really going to appreciate their music, too. And then finally, does anybody smell caramel here today when you walked in? That was no accident, all right? We've got caramel rolls for sale after the service is, please don't get up now, after the service is done, and this is a fundraiser to help our kids get to a mission trip in Cincinnati. So some wonderful treats, but you'll be doing a good thing as you buy those. So that's it for the announcements. Now, we want you to know that Bethel is a friendly place. We hope that you feel that way when you come here. So here's what I'm asking you to do. In a second, when I give you the signal, please stand, move across the room, find somebody you don't know. Just tell them you're glad that you're here. And then, meanwhile, we'd like to have the kids come forward. And if we've got kids down the hall or kids down in the, watching in the screen at the children's theater, come on and join us too. So here we go. I need some helpers here. Tell you what, will you stand up? Now, I want you to be very careful with this. Hold on to that. Turn around so they can just see what that is. Can you see it way in the back? Can you see what that is? Will you stand up? Can you hold that? Now, be very careful. Don't drop that on you or anybody else. Can you hold it up just a little bit? All right, how about this guy over here? Will you take that? Hold it very carefully, very tightly. All right, here's, all right, be very careful with that. Hold it tight. It's really... All right, now, what are we holding here? What are we holding here, boys and girls? That's right, you should back off a little bit. That's right. We trust them to a certain degree. All right, now let's start with the big ones first. Hand it back here. Good, 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 good. Now, what can you tell me about this?
It's a rock.
It's a rock. And what about it?
It's heavy.
It's heavy. All right, I was hoping you'd say that. How about that one? What would you say about this one?
It's a rock.
It's a heavy, and it's a rock as well. And this one?
It's flat,
and it is what? It was pretty heavy. It's pretty heavy. And you? What would you say? All right, how about a hand for the helpers? Let's hear from... Now, why are we talking about rocks? I'll tell you in just a second. But just remember, they are heavy. Even these little things that we got, they're pretty heavy. Now listen, boys and girls, tell me, when somebody dies in our world today, living in the United States of America or living in Hudson, Wisconsin, what do we do with the body today? What do? We put it in a coffin, and the coffin goes where?
In a graveyard.
In a graveyard, and which way does it go when it goes into a graveyard? Well, yeah, but do we put it up on sticks, or what do we do? You put it in the ground. We put it in the ground. So where we live, we dig graves in the ground, and then we put the coffin and the body down there, and then what do we do then? We cover them up. We cover them up. Now, I want you to think about this. Not everybody does burials that way. Did you know in Jesus' day, what they did was they, well, who knows? Who can tell me? What did they do in those days? Somebody we haven't heard from. They put the body in like one of those. What is one of those? What does that look like to you? Looks like a tomb. What would we call it over here? A hole? Would anybody, a cave? I heard a cave. In Jesus' day, they put bodies in caves like that. And then what do you see right next to that? Yeah. A boulder. It's a big stone. How much do you think that stone weighs? If these little ones weigh this much, how much do you think that big one weighs? Yeah.
It weighs like 1,000.
Like 1,000 pounds. It maybe does. How many people do you think it would take to move that stone? Yeah.
100.
Well, maybe not 100, but a few people. It would take a few men to move that. Now, listen, here's why we're talking about this today. We're going to read a story, and you know, Jesus has died, he was crucified, he was laid in a tomb that looked perhaps something like that. But before they left, what'd they do with that stone?
They put it over the
They rolled in front of it, okay? And they rolled it so nobody would go in there or animals wouldn't get in there or anything like that. Now listen, when the women are walking back to the tomb, they've got spices that they're going to put on the body of Jesus. And as they're walking, they say, well, we forgot about this. Who's going to roll away that stone? How many people, again, do you think it would take to move that stone if these rocks are this heavy? What do you think? Like 10 guys, maybe. And these are three women, and they're saying, who's going to roll that stone? But, boys and girls, you know the story. When they got to the tomb, what did they find?
An angel.
An angel, that's right. Just like they've been practicing. Very good. They found an angel, and where was the angel? He was in the tomb there. Now listen, listen. The stone had already been rolled away. It had already been rolled away. Who do you think did that? Were there 10 guys there to do that? You say the angel? Could have been the angel. Maybe the angel. What would you say? Jesus. Maybe Jesus got up and, you know. But in one way or the other, would you agree? And I heard somebody say this. God moved the stone. Isn't that true? Whether it was through an angel or through Jesus or just something supernatural, that stone was moved. The women didn't have to worry anymore who was going to roll the stone because it was gone. Now, here's the point for you, boys and girls, and me. We believe, as Christian people, as followers of Jesus, we believe that God moved that stone for Jesus on the first Easter morning, and we believe that someday God will roll the stone away for us. God will call us out of the grave. Now, it could be hundreds, thousands of years from now, but we believe that someday God will call us to eternal life. What does that mean? Eternal life. Yeah. Life forever. And where do we believe that's going to be? Who can help me? Yeah. Yeah. In heaven. We believe that's in heaven. Boys and girls, Christians make no apologies for this. We believe this. We believe that Jesus is the one that makes the stones roll, calls us back to life. That's what we're here to celebrate today. That's what we're going to be talking about today. Will you fold your hands, bow your heads, have a prayer with me? Then we got a little treat. Dear God, thank you for your amazing love and your amazing power. Thanks for calling us back to new life through the Easter promise. And let all the boys and girls together say, Amen.
All right, as the kids are making their way back to their seats, if you want to stand up, please, and sing with us, God is Able.
Defeated the grave, raised to life, our God is able. In His name we've overcome, for our Lord, our God is able. Us. God is on our side. He will make a way. Far above all we know, far above all we hope, He has done great things. Lift it up, He defeated the grave. Our God is able.
We begin our Easter celebration in the name of the living God, in the name of the Creator, the Savior, and the Redeemer of all life. Hallelujah. Let's join together in today's Easter litany. On the first day of the week, at dawn, the women went to his tomb with spices to anoint the body of Jesus. Instead, they were greeted by a messenger who told them not to fear.
He asked the women why they were looking for the living among the dead. Jesus was not there, but he was alive.
So today we come searching for the God of the ages, who broke the bonds of death and the grave.
He is risen.
He is alive. Hallelujah. Let's pray. O God, who rolled away the stone, we look to you to roll away the stones in our lives, in this world and the next. We ask for your freedom over life and death, as you freed your Son, Jesus, in life and in death. In his name and spirit, we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive. Because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because he lives. Dead in the grave, I heard the power of sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away. because he lives.
Well, thank you, Chase. Thank you, Peter. Well done. These are a couple of our ninth graders from the youth ministry here at Bethel. Friends, on this Easter morning, let's take a listen once again to the Easter Gospel. This is a scripture, the oldest scripture of the account that has been shared for generation after generation through the centuries. But listen to this. From Mark chapter 16, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they could go and anoint Jesus' body. Very early on that first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb. And as they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled away. And as they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You're looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He's risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he's going ahead of you into Galilee. And there you will see him, just as he told you." So trembling and bewildered, the women went out of the tomb and they fled. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. I'd be afraid too, wouldn't you? Friends, this is the good news of the Easter Gospel. Hang on to that for just a moment, and let me tell you a story. Anna Pavlova was a superstar of the Russian ballet back in the early 1900s. All right? Anna Pavlova. She was declared the greatest ballerina of all time in her day. But listen to this. Anna's most memorable performance took place after her death. How does that work? Her most memorable performance took place after her death. See, Anna had been scheduled to play the role that she had made famous called the Dying Swan. I'm not going to do any of that for you here today, and you're glad that I'm not. But she was ready to perform this at the Apollo Theater in London, England. Tragically, 2 days before that performance, she got pneumonia and she died. And if you know anything about ballet, well, at least what I've been told, is the show must go on. The show continues. And so on the appointed evening, even though the star was dead, a crowd of her faithful fans packed the Apollo Theater. The lights went down, the orchestra began to play, the curtain went up, and then the spotlights blazed and they began to shine around the stage. And everybody stood up so they could see where the spotlight was up on the stage. They were on their feet. And they watched as the spotlight moved from one place to another where Anna would have been, could have been, had she been alive. And the audience remembered her in their hearts and their minds. They remembered this beautiful, talented ballerina. They tried to imagine just that beautiful white costume that she would have had and those world-class moves. And when the music finally ended and they did the whole deal, they did the whole number that night without a main ballerina on the stage. But when it was done, the audience rose to their feet and they gave her one last standing ovation to their dear Anna, and that ovation echoed on into the night. That's a true story, by the way. Sound a little crazy to you? Because it does to me. An empty stage, lots of memories, wishful thinking. Friends, is that what brings us here today on Easter morning? An empty stage, lots of memories, and wishful thinking? Is that all the Christian faith is a remembrance or a glorification of a folk hero that died some 2,000 years ago? Is that all we're here for today? Because there are people in the world that would say yes to that question. I have to tell you, when I was a high school kid and I was sitting out in the audience or the pews like you are today or the chairs at an Easter service, I remember time after time asking a question about the Easter story. How do we know that it's true? How do we know it's true? What if it's a hoax? Could it just be the attempts to keep Jesus alive in the memories of his followers, kind of like the story I just shared about Anna Pavlova with her faithful friends and followers. My guess is, when I look around, my guess is many of you have asked that question sometime in life. In fact, there may be those of you that are asking it this very morning. How do we know it's all true? I know there are people everywhere that have doubts. Listen, this same question was asked by a man by the name of Lee Strobel a few years ago. He was an award-winning journalist for the Chicago Daily Herald, which, by the way, is the longest-running newspaper in the Chicago area. But Strobel had always been an atheist and a skeptic with anything that he couldn't see or taste or touch. And when his wife became a Christian in the early 1990s, well, like most husbands, Lee set out to prove that this was just a fraud. It was just a fantasy, but there was really nothing to it. That's the way husbands are sometimes, isn't it? And as a good journalist, Strobel went to work reading the Bible, studying the accounts. In fact, he went on to interview a number of believers from literally all over the country. And yet, the more that he researched, the more that he did, the more that he learned, the more that he came to believe, there was something to all this. And especially when it came to the resurrection of Jesus. Strobel wrote about this in a book that he wrote called The Case for Christ, in which he talks about his conversion to the Christian faith. Are you catching what I'm telling you today? This is a guy that set out to prove that it wasn't true. But in the process of that, what happened to him? He got in God's way, and he ended up becoming a believer. He ended up becoming a believer because the more he studied, the more he called it the undeniable evidence. Mr. Strobel's main argument for the Christian faith was this, or main question: if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, then where's his body? It's a simple question, isn't it? Jesus didn't rise from the dead, where's his body? For 20 centuries now, both friends and enemies of Jesus have been searching for that body. Mr. Strobel reasoned, if Jesus was a threat to the world when he was alive, which is true, which is why he was put to death on the cross, if he was a threat to the world while he was alive, he was double the threat when the story started to circulate that he had resurrected from the dead. And you can be sure that all the enemies of Jesus, whether they were Jewish, whether they were Roman, they could have crushed the Christian faith in its cradle from its very beginning if all they would have done was drag out a dead corpse of Jesus and say, what are you talking about, risen? Look at him. He's dead. But friends, the truth of history is they didn't do that. They couldn't do that because he wasn't dead. He was alive. Strobel went on to note that some of the critics have suggested, well, maybe the friends of Jesus, the disciples of Jesus, stole the body to make it look like Jesus rose from the tomb. And yet Strobel sees some major problems to this theory. The first would be, this sort of deception or dishonesty goes against everything that Jesus had ever shared or imparted or taught to his followers. It just goes against Jesus. Secondly, a stunt like that, stealing the body, would pit them up against the most powerful army in the world at that time, which was who? The Roman army. And believe me, as talented or untalented as these 12 disciples were, there was no way that they could outsmart the Roman army or outmuscle the Roman army. So that doesn't sound like a very plausible idea. And thirdly, Strobel notes that each of the disciples went to their very death insisting that they had seen with their own eyes the risen Christ. He concludes this. He says, men and women will die for what they believe is true, but they will not die for what they know is a lie or clearly a hoax. Did you hear that? Men and women will die for what they believe is true, but they will not die for what they clearly know is a lie or a hoax. You know, if something like this could have ever happened, hiding the body of Jesus might have seemed like a clever idea until the first time that the executioner's whip came down on your back, and then like most human beings, they'd be fessing up to what they did really quickly. But Strobel goes on to point out the disciples never changed their story about seeing the resurrected Christ. No matter what kind of torture their enemies threw at them, and there was some terrible torture, they never changed the tomb. And Strobel would say, this is a powerful testimony of these people. What's more, He goes on to emphasize the incredible transformation that took place in these 12 disciples. You know these stories, don't you? Prior to Jesus' death, if you were to look at those 12 disciples, you would have to say they were nothing but sniveling cowards. Sniveling cowards. Because if you recall, when Jesus was apprehended in the Garden of Gethsemane, remember that story? Where were the disciples? They were running for their lives. In fact, one of them ran so quickly that it says that he left his cloak, he left his clothes in the captor's hands. He was the first streaker running through the garden naked there that day. And secondly, you know the story of Peter. Peter was confronted. Aren't you a friend of Jesus? Three times they asked him this in the court time. And three times he said what? Don't know the guy. Don't know the guy. Three times he denied Jesus. And then thirdly, when Jesus was actually being crucified on the cross, do you remember how many of the disciples were there to witness that, to be a part of that? One. The other 11 were at home hiding under their beds, fearing for their very lives. You get the picture. Prior to Jesus' death, the disciples were cowards. But after his death, after his appearance, they became courageous heroes. And it's a fact of history that they turned around, telling the world about Jesus, turning the world upside down about Jesus, and nothing could seem to shut them up. Lee Strobel asks this question. He says, what made the quantum difference in the lives and the character of those 12 disciples? And he would say the answer is quite simple. It's the resurrected Christ. They saw him, and it changed their lives forever. Now, I know there's some people maybe here today that would ask, well, is it really that important that he rose physically from the grave? I mean, can't we just remember him in our memory, and isn't that enough? But I tell you this, nothing could be more important than Jesus having a bodily resurrection from the grave. As the Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, and some of you know these words, he said, we are all to be most pitied if Christ didn't rise from the dead. Now, he's not just speaking about himself, he's speaking about you too and me. We are all to be most pitied if Jesus did not rise from the dead. Christianity would be nothing more than a museum piece or a sentimentality if Jesus hadn't risen from the dead. If Jesus hadn't come out of the grave, hate, violence, and death, they've won out in this world. If Jesus didn't come out of the grave, then none of us have been forgiven of any sins. If Jesus didn't come out of the grave, then there's very little reason for any hope or any life or love in this world. And if Jesus didn't come out of the grave, then we can only live and die in this crazy world, in this absurd world, knowing that there's nothing more to look forward to, nothing ahead, nothing to come. Again, I tell you, everything hinges in the Christian faith on the fact that Jesus physically rose from that tomb. But if he did indeed rise, then that changes everything about life for you and me. Not just about death, but it changes everything about life. Now, friends, you know this. We cannot prove in the scientific sense Jesus' resurrection. And why? To do something by the scientific method, what does it have to be? It has to be repeatable. You have to be able to do it again to prove it, right? Gravity, you prove gravity by dropping an apple again and again and again. You can't prove events of history. We can't repeat them. They're one-time events. But they do say this about life. You can tell how large a ship is by the wake that it leaves behind it. You know what I mean by that? As a ship moves through the water, it leaves a wake. A small little boat leaves a small little wake. A big ship leaves a huge wake. Think about this. Think about the large wake that Jesus Christ has left in this world these last centuries. He brought the Roman Empire to its very knees. Do you know your history? Do you know that for the first couple hundred years, the Roman Empire tried to put the lid on the Christian faith? They couldn't do it. The more they tried to beat the Christians down, the more they rose up. Finally, in 325, they finally said, the Emperor Constantine said, we just can't seem to beat these Christians. If we can't beat them, let's join them. So he passed a decree that now it wasn't just the Roman Empire, it was the Holy Roman Empire. And now we're all Christians here. He brought the Roman Empire to its knees. We also know that part of the wake that he left was the fact that we date time in the Western world by what? Those little letters, B.C., A.D. It all has to do with when Jesus came and left. The other part of the wake that he left is hundreds of thousands of churches line, not just our country, but line the entire world and have for centuries. That's quite a feat. He's changed millions. No, he's changed literally billions of lives, this living God. That's part of the wake that Jesus has left. Nobody else has ever had their story told and retold and told again as many times as Jesus has, telling the gospel story. And finally, nowhere else in all of human history do you ever find any claims of somebody resurrecting from the dead as Jesus did. I tell you this, that wake that he left, it wasn't the corpse of a dead man that brought all that out. What you hear me saying is this, Easter is no stranger to reason. We as Christians, we use our minds, we use our logic, we use our intelligence to bring us to these conclusions to a certain point. But I would also say there is a point that faith needs to kick in. And so it's on a morning like this, too, that we also look to our faith that takes us beyond where reason can take us. Faith tells us this morning, because Jesus overcame hate and violence with love, you and I can do that, too. We can live different lives in the world around us. Faith tells us this morning that because Jesus was raised from the dead, hope is alive and well in your life and in mine. And not just when it comes to the grave and death, but in every situation in life. Do you believe that? Do you know that? That there is no hopeless situation with God in our lives. And finally, faith tells us today that as Jesus overcame death, as we said with the kids just a few minutes ago, he gives us that promise, you and me, that we too will have that stone rolled away and we too will rise again. Now listen, some of you have heard me tell this story at some of the funerals that we've had here at Bethel through the years, but it's a story about Winston Churchill. There's some things that you probably know about Churchill. He served as the Prime Minister for Great Britain back in the 1900s. What you may not know about Churchill is that Churchill was a fairly flamboyant character. When he did stuff, he did it with flair. You know, you always knew when Churchill was around and was in the room. So here's the deal. Winston Churchill had a hand in planning his own funeral years before he died. And so when the day finally came and he was being buried and they were doing the service at St. Paul's Cathedral there in London, England, here's what happened. As the priest was giving the last words in the service, Churchill had arranged for a bugler to be up on one side of the dome of the cathedral. And with his bugle, he began to do taps. You know taps, don't you? Do, 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 do. Do you know the words for taps? Day is done, day is done. You get the point. Kind of fitting for a funeral, isn't it? Day's done, life is over, let's lay him to rest. But that wasn't enough for Churchill. As that bugler ended his piece, he had arranged for another bugler to be on the other side of the dome, and he kicked in with reveille. You know reveille? You know that one? You know the words to reveille? It's time to get up, it's time to get up, it's time to get up in the morning. You see, for Winston Churchill, this was not cheap theatrics. This was a statement of faith. He truly believed that there was a God on the other side of the grave that would call him back to life. Friends, I tell you, this same God who rolled away the stone for Jesus promises to roll away your stone and my stone in the same way that he rolled away the stone for Winston Churchill those years ago. We tend to think that a cemetery is a place for the dead, a place of inactivity and silence, and a place where the dead rest in peace. But here's the deal. The Easter promise says someday those cemeteries are going to be places of great activity as you and I and others that believe are called to life and called to eternity. On this Easter day, I hope there's no one that leaves the place this morning without believing, not just hearing these words, but believing. Stones will roll for you and for me. New life will begin. The promise that Jesus gave us will be fulfilled, and God's power will be undeniable at that time in your life and in mine. I know we're Lutherans here, but let me just hear you say, alleluia.
Alleluia.
Now let me hear you say it like you mean it.
Alleluia.
Let's pray. Gracious God, we just thank you for this incredible promise. We thank you for this incredible history that you've led us to. And God, we look forward to the next chapters that are yet to be written. Continue to lead us and guide us. God, call us by name to be a part of your kingdom. All these things we ask and pray on this day, and let all the people of God this morning say, amen. Amen. Friends, let's stand and sing together.
Arise, arise, arise,
Amen. Now let us confess our faith together through the words on the screen. We believe in the God of life-giving power, who created all things and recreates each and every day. We believe in the God of unstoppable love, who risked suffering and death to demonstrate the degree of his commitment to us. We believe in the God of unquenchable hope, when it looked like the end had come and the fire had been extinguished, he bounced back with a torch burning brightly. We believe in the God of unbroken promises. This God has proven himself faithful throughout time and will never, ever cease to amaze us in the future. Hallelujah. We believe in God, and this God believes in us. Amen. Now let us join together in our offering prayer. Join me, please. Our great and generous God, we give back to you today, perhaps not as we ought, but as we are able. Use our gifts to continue your work in compassion and to share the life-changing news of Jesus' resurrection. Amen. You may be seated as we gather our first and our best, an offering to the Lord.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain, I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness fades to light, and the shadows disappear, and my face shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is over. Risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. I will rise.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you this day and keep you always in his grace. Amen.
Now, if you would bow your heads in prayer, let's close with an Easter prayer. Our gracious God, on this day you conquered death, rose to new life, and returned to share it with us. You've offered a new story for our lives, our world, and our future. Lord, help us to see and believe your story is now our story. Continue to give us hope, peace, and promise, even in the face of death. And as we go today, help us to live as your Easter people. May your living light continue to shine through us in all we say and do. Thank you for the privilege to be your sons and daughters in this family of faith. In your name we pray. Amen. And before we sing our closing song, receive this Easter blessing. Now go as God's Easter people, marked with his cross, filled with his hope, and sharing his love. In the name of our living Lord Jesus Christ, amen. Now let's sing our closing song together.
My shame is taken away. My pain is healed in his name. I believe. I'll raise a banner.
Now go as people who know real hope because Jesus is alive.
We go to be God's resurrection people.
Happy Easter. God is great. Alleluia on this awesome Easter day.